It falls back to what the Luxembourg, those who do not move do not notice their chains. Friedrich James, the famous, said, "It is easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism." Now to the cinema, what are the documents about? Mark Fisher identified the current neoliberal culture with the term capitalist realism. Capitalist realism is the widespread idea that capitalism is the only realistic political economic system. And it does no longer present itself as the best social system among others, but as the only game in town. For Fisher, it was the collapse of the socialist states of the Eastern Bloc that helped legitimize this new form of ideology. He suggests that a capitalist realism is the first really successful totalitarian ideological system, in a sense that it permeates deep into your psyche and thus structuring your understanding of the possible. Under conditions of capitalist realism, the idea of any practical alternative to capitalism becomes not just unrealistic, but literally unthinkable. So if you think that there is no alternative, you live in an atemporal space in which you have reached the end of history, and thus also reached the end of the future, leaving you in an eternal present where everything repeats itself constantly without any reference to the past. Back to Berlin, which is now starting to lose its connection to the past very rapidly. Berlin used to be that place where artists went to because it was affordable. For the past 5 years, rents have gone up for 6% every year. Housing has become a profitable market. Global players like Google and Zalando are buying themselves into Kreuzberg, thus skyrocketing prices ever more. To give you an example, a friend of mine has been living in a 45 square meter apartment for 12 years now. Her contract is cheap and old. She pays 330 euros for everything. That's about 10,000 hryvnia. Her neighbor on the same floor, who recently moved in, is paying 950 euros for the same flat, which is about 28,500 hryvnia. His landlord told him, "You're lucky, this is the Manhattan of Berlin." If he would not have taken the flat, there would have been many others waiting for it. Moneymakers exploit the city and come up with arguments about rents in Hong Kong or London to justify their greed. De facto, I care about Hong Kong's rents. What does this have to do with that? A lot of New Yorkers are flooding the city for the past 3 years, and for them this is still super cheap and paradise. Expat people who go where it's cheap on a global scale usually don't partake in learning the language or engage in political ways. So they come, make the city cool, and when prices are up, they leave. Don't get me wrong, it is great to have the freedom and opportunity to travel and live where you like on this earth, but there are downsides to it. First of all, it is a privilege. It is the new digital colonialism, an option available only for very few people on this earth. Second, it is the way to operate for global companies. They offer you a position for 1 or 2 years, a flat, a car, a whole bubble of Western culture for you to hide in. On the extreme opposite, millions of people flee their countries because of war or climate change. Third, the world is not ready for political engagement outside of your birth country. We, for example, coming from Austria, are not allowed to engage politically in Germany because our Austrian citizenship forbids it, even though we are part of the European Union and have been living and paying taxes in Germany for about 15 years now. Nevertheless, we need to take some action to not end up in a streamlined, depressing life in which we dull ourselves with Netflix series and blockbusters telling us about the end of the world, blaming our discomforts and anxieties rather on refugees than looking reality into the eye and saying, "This is actually not good anymore." Because it's a very depressing thing to do. But it's the one thing that moves an individual forward to look your weakness in the eye, to acknowledge it, to know it, and then overcome your fear and develop further. And I think the same principle is it replies to a society because it is formed by individuals. It is time to wake up, look at the low ceiling, kick your head at it really hard and solidarize with others. Because it is not your personal problem, as most of us still think, because of not working hard enough or being efficient enough. It is a societal problem and a global problem. And it will be tough to find a new narrative and new language to deal with people telling you that this is it and no alternatives, please. So where to start? We want to work with the texts that surround us and came up with a simple algorithm that for now does nothing more than reassemble texts and replace words with others. We remix like we do in music, we punk start, not yet knowing where it will lead us, but the start it is.
So yeah, that was pretty straightforward. I tend to digress a little bit when I do talks, so I apologize for that. Sometimes it gets a bit clusterfucked, but we'll see where we end. I have to go back to the beginning, like personal motivation. Some talk is always good to talk about personal motivation. Why are we here? Why are we doing this? Why did we come to Kiev? I have a lot of stuff to do. I have a family, I have two little children. I go to school, I work, I practice Kung Fu, I do yoga, I do shit, also stuff. Why come to Kiev? Because I do believe it is very important to communicate, to talk to a lot of people, to make connections. It was also for us very important to kickstart our own project. Because for now it was just like a theory. We've been sitting around talking about it. We know what we want to do, essentially. Judith talked about the content now most of the time, and I will talk about the form, the method, how we will make this book basically, and what tradition in art history there is, where does it come from, where do we root ourselves with them. But we wouldn't have started if it wasn't for coming to Kiev. We would have been sitting at home, I guess, another 2 months and just blah, 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 blah. That's a tendency for people living in rich countries. They just sit around and go, blah, 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 blah. There's no need to take action. There's no rush. We're not hungry. You had a revolution here, so however that came out, yeah, I talked to a lot of people yesterday night, actually, and I had a lot of hopes were crushed, actually. We didn't get out of the revolution what you were expecting. But I do believe we need a revolution on a way larger scale, like everywhere. Because I watched a movie about the situation in Ukraine yesterday coming here, and there was one guy I was talking about. I want freedom, I'm a free human being, I want the freedom, I want to be part of Europe. And I was constantly thinking, do you even know what it means? The freedom that you have living in Europe, living in Germany, is you can go to KFC, McDonald's or Burger King. That's about it. I know it's very simplified, but that's more or less about it. There's no chance to live outside the system, unless you live on the street. So if you want Europe, that's what you'll get. And you can always see it in Kiev as well. You have little glimpses of Europe already. Like 10% are making a lot of money, and the rest, who knows. And in Berlin, because 20 years ago we had the same thing, 30 years ago, the wall came down, there were a lot of hopes. Wow, and then we become this new utopia. The East and the West emerged into a new society. Nothing happened. We got capitalism full on. That's about it. So hopefully, something new will emerge from this part of the world or any part of the world, or just a group of individuals that travel the world and share ideas, get together, try to do stuff and bring some sort of positive change. So now, like I said, I was digressing a lot, because this should take like 10 seconds by then. So, let's talk about the method, and let's talk about a book. Why do we make a book? We are basically audiovisual artists. We mostly make movies. Judith's more graphic designer, I do films, most of the time motion design and installation. Why make a book? First of all, that's very simple. We really, really like books. I love books. I have them around me. My daughters start to read now. It's a beautiful thing. They never let you down. You can take them with you. They're filled with ideas. You can share them. You can spread them around. Beautiful medium. We actually do believe in the power of the written word. It's been around for such a long time. And even if people call the internet like the new media, it's not true. Most of the stuff that you see on the web, except for cat videos, is text, text, text. Of course, there's video as well, but there's shit loads of words. So the written word, it has a lot of power to it. And it's also kind of easy. Like you need a pen and paper or a notebook and some time. How you publish it, how you pay for it, that's a different thing. But money just comes and goes, and you find people to to print it in the end, or you print it yourself. But like making it is kind of easy. It's just an intellectual work. Then again, it's also many times people have said, the book is dying, the book market is going down, magazines are going down. We want to oppose that, we don't believe that. In numbers, it's not true actually, because there's more and more books published every year. So that's not true. We want to add to that, because we think books are just fucking great. And in our line of work, we just simply feel oversaturated with images, because that's what we do for a living all the time, so we try to be nice for change to work with. Text, plus there will be images, of course. There will also be a website that accompanies the whole book project, and of course it will have video and images as well. But the focus is words, and the power of words. So why do we make a book with these specific methods that I'm talking about a little bit later? Just a minute. The methods that we're using is mainly used in other art forms for a long, long period now. You know these words, sentiment, like randomness, appropriation. If anyone doesn't know, if you take something out of one culture, for example, and make it your own. It's also a negative term sometimes. The Americans talk about cultural appropriation all the time. People shouldn't do yoga in the West because it's stealing from the Indians, which is PC bullshit, basically. But sometimes appropriation happens in a negative way. That is true. But appropriation also means that you take something out of the context, put it into your own context, and give it a new meaning. And plagiarism, which is simply stealing. All these methods, of course, overlap and have a lot in common, but they have like specific differences. That's like the main method how we make our book. We also write text our own, but we steal a lot. And this has been happening in art all the time, like in collage, in movies, every music video is basically just stolen somehow. So we are interested in the process. We believe that all the ideas are already out there, and we want to give our own spin, our own vector, our own direction. We like the idea from taking from this huge, vastly, it's just something like huge, big cultural, intellectual realm that already exists. There's so much beautiful stuff out there. We just want to mix it up and make something new. We like the idea of sharing these ideas after we have reframed them towards our own designs and ideas. And last but not least, we feel that this works as sort of an anti-consumerist strategy. If you take stuff that already exists, reframe it, and then share it with others, instead of producing something entirely new. I mean, the project at the end might be something entirely new, but all the ingredients have been there already. Yeah? So, on to the next one. The guy that, when we talked about the content, which you did now explain, which is Mark Fisher more or less, and all the stuff that he wrote about, it's not only Mark Fisher, but some of his main concepts. At the same time, I was reading a book by this guy, Kenneth Goldsmith, which is just about writing. He's a more or less conceptual artist, but his medium is words. He doesn't go to any other material, but he looks at words as material. It's not just like written text on a paper, it's like clay, it's like paint, it's like stone, it's like wood for him. Words are something that you can take and shape and form into whatever you like. So that's the basis. His ideas and his book are the basis for the formal aspects and the methods that we use in our project. The book is called Uncreative Writing. I don't know if you know that, but there's like thousands of online courses and college and university courses, especially in the English-speaking world, that are called creative writing. Learn how to become a writer. Become a famous writer. Have your books sold at airports and whatnot. And it follows certain formulas and principles that are very simplistic. And you end up with boring books. The same stories again and again. So he's talking about uncreative writing, which leaves space for the ungenius. Because if you think about writers, we think about these guys sitting at home, drinking wine, being like, having heavy thoughts, like one sentence a day, and it takes years to finish a book. And that's like the genius idea that we have. That's how a writer is supposed to be, all on his own, and creating this universe of ideas. Maybe not. Maybe writing could be completely different. Like, take all this text that is already out there, steal it, take it, assemble it to a new text, shape it, and put it out. So this is the ungenius. Like the genius, he comes out with his own ideas. The ungenius just takes and reframes things, gives it his or her own spin. So this is Ungenius, that's what David Hasselhoff is saying, because he's also an Ungenius and he made a career as David Hasselhoff. I don't know if you know him, probably most of you are too young to know David Hasselhoff. But yeah, Kenneth Goldsmith sees the new writer more as a curator of words, of text, a collector of words, of text, a sampler of words, of text, an editor of text, and maybe even a programmer. A lot of his book, if you ever want to read it, I'm going to write it by Kenneth Goldsmith, is about programming text. That's why we have an algorithm just as a jump start to get some text that is generated by a machine. But of course, we can take this text and reshape it, reformulate it, and bring it into this specific form that we see fit for our content. But this is how he sees the role of the future writer. Of course, there will always be like normal writers that sit at home and write novels. But writers can be so much more. And in all the other disciplines, in art, this is already happening. I mean, nobody invented design again and again and again. It's just stealing, taking, appropriating, sampling, reconfiguring, reframing. This happens in every form. But if it comes down to writing, this seems to be like the holy temple. If someone accuses you of stealing just like one paragraph without making notice of this, through footnotes or whatever, you basically fuck. And there's been many cases of writers who basically you did that, someone found out, the books have to be burned, more or less. So, very weird. Why is this with writing? I mean, music. We do music like this for decades now. You sample stuff, that's so normal. Why not with text? So this is a quote, or it's a paraphrased quote, which is not the exact quote, but how I reformulate it. From a guy called Marcel, who's always a friend of the Kenneth Goldsmith guy, and he said the world is full of text, more or less interesting, and I don't want to add anything to that. And he also said, if you want to take my text, the name of the game is Give All. You're welcome to all my facts, basically to all these texts. You know them, I give them to you, when you have the strength to pick them up, take them. With my blessings, do something good with it. Yeah? I have no contract issues whatsoever. I'm not going to sue you if you take my text. If that's what you want to do, do it. Spread it with other people. Don't make it a sacred thing. Now I have to look at my notes because I'm digressing a lot right now. But it's fine. Go with the flow. So yeah. Because if you think about it, substantially, like all ideas, everything that you've seen in the cinema has been taken from somewhere, has been taken from somewhere. Neurological studies have shown that even memory, like imagination and the consciousness itself, is stitched, kilted, pastiched, and more or less cut and pasted together. That's how memory functions, at least what neurological science tells us right now. They say new shit every 10 years, so who knows? But for now, that's the state of the art. So we can also forgive this to our artworks and just say, okay, that's how we make art, fine. We stitch stuff together, we steal stuff, we plagiarize, let's be open about it. Let's just do it and have fun, in this, in our case, with text. So, there's a couple of key methods that Kenneth Goldsmith is writing and talking about in his book. Plumbagraphia is something, it's a word construction, it doesn't exist. I'll just read them out loud and then I'll explain a little bit what they are. There's plumbagraphia, there's cut and paste, everybody knows that. It's in graphic design, it's like if you work with Photoshop, cut and paste. And it's been there for centuries. Plagiarism, like I said, which is basically just stealing and hiding the fact that you are stealing. And in a sense, which is a method that everybody knows for making music, but it can also be used for text. Plumbagraphia is sort of interesting because it's a more general practice where you take maybe incomplete chunks of text and put it into a completely different context. Yeah? It could be combining, which is a very basic example, a text from a fairy tale, a text about people going to shopping centers with images of from a zombie movie. And you get an entirely different context that totally makes sense. Zombies and people in shopping centers. It's, yeah, that's plumbagraphia. You just reframe it. Very bold, actually. Not, you don't even add anything. It's just that you take two things, put them into a new frame, and there you go. Cut and paste is different, it's really like, you know, I think there's a lot of visual artists here, or students are in the field of design. It's cut and paste. You cut stuff out and then you reassemble it and put it together. I already said plagiarism is just stealing, which can be fine. If you're good with it, if you think it's good for your karma, then just steal. The underlying method of all this basically is cut and paste. Because even if you take like big paragraphs like you plumb the ref and put the unit together, it's cutting and pasting, cutting and pasting. And this idea is very old. I don't know if you know William S. Burroughs, I also call him the acid priest. He did a lot of drugs, but he also was a very great poet and thinker of theory about text, filmmaking, and other things, actually, exploring the mind, evolving as a human being. And he said that all writing, in fact, is cut-ups. Not meaning that all of writing is pieced together with a scissor and glue, but it's all a collage of words that at one point in your life you have read somewhere, that you heard somewhere, or that you just overheard somewhere, subconsciously getting to you. There's nothing new. We all use the same language. I mean, obviously you speak a different language, but we use words to communicate. So, all writing is in fact couples. And that's how that mistake looks. I mean, we've seen it. It's kind of, I'm not saying it's boring, but it's nothing new. And that's like the first real cut-up poetry. And Borrows didn't invent it. It goes way back to actually the Dadaists, especially Christian Schaba, who wrote a little text how to make a Dadaist poem. Now we switch through that because there's a series of images of different methods where you could cut and paste together text. Besides the content, which can be beautiful, it also creates beautiful images, yeah, if you design them in a specific way. This is another quite interesting method actually, where you just erase stuff. Yeah? So it's not adding stuff or putting stuff together, you take a page and then you just simply erase words to get your own content. What is? So I want to create it now. So here's a little movie now. William S. Burroughs is explaining his method. He's hard to understand. It's all the drugs.
Now these experiments started not on tape recorders, but on paper. In 1959, Brian Geisen said that writing is 50 years behind painting, and applied the montage technique to words on a page. And this technique had already been used in painting that time for 50 years, looking back I have old hat in painting. Brian copied out phrases from newspapers and magazines, then took a scissors and cut these selections into pieces and rearranged the fragments at random. And these cut-up experiments appeared in Minutes to Go in 1959. When you experiment with cut-ups over a period of time, you find that some of the cut-ups and rearranged text seem to refer to future events. I cut up an article on written by John Paul Getty, and it's a bad thing to sue your own father. This was a rearrangement and wasn't in the original text. And a year later, one of his sons did sue. We had no explanation for this at the time, just a suggestion that perhaps when you cut into the present, the future leaks down. Well, we simply accepted it and continued the experiments. The next step was cut-ups on the tape recorder, and Brian was the first to take this obvious step. Now here are some tapes which Brian made with all the technical facilities of the BBC in London, and they show, I think, what can be done with a human voice in one phrase.
All actors calling all actors is free, calling all actors is free, calling all actors is free, calling all industry actors, calling all reagents active, calling all actors is free, calling all industry actors, calling all actors is free, 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 seconds, we are on. Reactivating all going. Reactivating all going. Reaction starting to move on. Recalling all transmissions. Recalling active engines all. Recalling engine active.
So yeah, and the weird thing, I didn't even know that before working on this book project that Tristan Charles started the whole idea of cover poetry, but Boris took it to the next level because he had other media and other access to different media. And I didn't know that people like David Bowie, Kurt Cobain, Tom York from Radiohead, even the Beatles were highly influenced by this method. And David Bowie, a lot of his lyrics were basically naming his fashion, just cutting up text. And then reconfiguring it, pulling out, and just writing it down. And so he invented the whole genre of art rock. There's a little video where he talks about David Bowie, about how he uses this method, and obviously has used it a lot.
This is the way I do my stuff. I don't know if it's like when Van's Gaston does this or Barrows does this, I don't know. This is the way I do. I've used this method only on a couple of actual songs, but I've used it for more than anything else. There's igniting anything that might be my imagination, and it can often come out very interesting as it's used to look into. I'm trying to hear the drivers and things, and that's funny and amazing things I've heard. Nearly what I'd done, where I was going. A lot of the things I've done, it seemed that it would predict things about the future, or something a lot about the past. It's really quite astonishing. I suppose it's a very Western term. I don't know. Anyway, let's see what happens.
The difference was that Cobain was plagiarizing himself. He was basically just taking his own poetry, his own diaries, and rearranging them and cutting them. David Bowie was actually plagiarizing other people's work. So that's also a difference. You can steal from yourself, more or less, in your dreams or whatever. So, all this would not have happened without Dada. Like I said, they came up with the whole cut and paste method, in words, but also for their graphic design. They are the inventors of, in a way, of cut and paste, you could say. And this is how Chara actually wrote this sound, how to make a Dadaist poem. It's very simple. I simplified it even further, because I don't want to read the whole thing, but basically just make a newspaper, you cut out stuff, put it into a bag, a hat, or whatever, shake it, take out the different things, and then rearrange them to text. That's one method. There's thousands. There's no right or wrong how to do this, but this is one first methods that he basically described. And all their layouts and their method design is based on this whole cut and paste idea. I don't want to talk about Dadaism like in general, that's a huge topic, I think, but I want to say that I love Dadaism. Like all art forms or traditions in art, I think Dadaism is just the greatest because it does match with my brain, I guess, the most. And I've been a punk when I was younger, and Dadaism and punk is just like so connected. There wouldn't have been any punk without Dadaism. The whole territory, if you look at all the fancies that the punks did in the 70s and 80s, it's Dada right there. We don't want to go fancy like this, but like the attitude and the approach that is behind these forms of publications, that's what we want to take. Because they didn't think about how do we get this published? Oh, we don't have any money, we need some funding. No, it doesn't matter. Start to do your book, get your shit together, and there will be a way how you'll get it published. Maybe someone in Ukraine or someone of you actually knows someone who prints books here. And it's obviously cheaper to do it here than to do it in Germany. So, if you do actually, let us know. But now we're going to dump it. So yeah, more. It's been in the hardcore punk scene for decades. It's cup and paste. This is actually made by a woman whose name I always forget. It's Laura something, and she's been friends with Mark Fisher that Judith talked about in the beginning. And she has this magazine called Savage Messiah, which still exists as an online thing and as a book project that comes out again and again and again. It's about the gentrification of London, more or less, and the whole change that is happening in the UK, which, as you might know, is one of the most neoliberal and therefore brutal countries in Europe. That's why it went out of the EU to become even more neoliberal, or whatever they are doing on this fucking island. Who knows? But yeah, that's another cut and paste magazine. More fences. And this whole thing even went big in popular culture, like from skateboard magazine to, popular punk music. It did spread quite a lot. So now I'm going to show just a little small piece of a movie that I made a few years ago that was more or less made with sort of the same algorithm that we're using now, but just for images. It's the same thing. There was a database of movies and stuff from the internet that I just fed into, and I had an algorithm to edit it. That's about it. And then I had like 20 different edits, and I took one, reshaped it a little bit, composed music underneath it, and it's not like I'm super proud of the movie. That's not what I'm showing, but that the method was the same. So just to, again, so you can use this for everything, yeah? For text, for images, for sound, it doesn't really matter. And I'll stop at some point because it's quite depressing and we don't want to watch the thing.
Sure.
So that was not the whole thing. The whole thing is not very long. This is just a short little edit. And of course it was not completely random. The whole edit was random, but the ending obviously not. The whole thing with the battery on and that's what I meant. You can
use a moderator to do the work for you, but if you want to have it in a very specific form and a specific message, you're allowed to edit it again and again and again, and then reframe it to that certain point where you get across your own idea. And the music that obviously was composed for this piece to, again, reframe it. So, I don't know if anyone knows this movie, They Live. Great movie by John Carpenter. Why is this image in there? Because, like I said in the beginning, we do believe in the power of the word and the messages that they convey, and also symbols and icons and all the stuff that surrounds us all the time. And this movie is basically about a guy who finds a pair of glasses and then he suddenly realizes that he's just surrounded by all these messages all the time, like buy stuff, obey, do this, that. It's also a very simplistic message. And it's a trashy movie, but at that time it came out, I thought, wow, this is great. It's so punk, it's so straight, just to the point what capitalism and consumer society is basically about. Just consume, conform, do your thing, do your job, don't leave the world, just stay, live until you die, pay taxes, and that's great. That's not something that I want of life. That's not something that I want of life, especially for my beautiful children. I hope that they will be something else than just consumerists. I hope that you all will be something else than consumerists. So we see our project, it's not revolutionary, but it's we want to add to culture with our own positive message and find methods how to get out of this cycle, which I personally find highly destructive. And if you paid attention to the movie I just showed a little bit, you might know how I feel about Western culture. It pretty much sums it up. I'm not too happy about it. So in a society that has destroyed all adventure, the only adventure left is to destroy actually that society. And that's what consumer capitalism and capitalist realism is more or less doing. This is still as far as we can. Who's a dangerous man? As he said, what we need to do is we need to disrupt the fabric of reality. And to do that, we need to proclaim more or less a new era. We have to say, my enemies feel esoteric and crazy because the guy that did heroin for like 50 years, LSD, acid, and all sorts of drugs. But in his core, he was a very intellectual and very smart and sensitive human being. You should never forget that when someone tells you, oh, but William Scott, he was just a junkie. No, no, he was not. That's why he influenced so many artists and theorists, even philosophers. When he says replace alien language, he doesn't mean aliens coming from outer space. He doesn't mean governments. He means PR strategies that come up with these languages that make us conform and buy stuff. Even our parents that tell us, you have to behave this way. Little girls have to wear pink, there are specific toys for them, and da da da. This is alien language. This has nothing to do with you as an individual. This is stuff that is imposed on you. And if you want to be a free human being and develop your own free will, you have to get rid of all that shit. That also means destroy and neutralize all alien gods. The Catholic Church, whatever church. If you like it, that's good, it's fine for you. But if you don't, if you feel there's something else out there, go get it, explore it for yourself. The rest is kind of self-explanatory. This one is very revolutionary. Take away the money and the land from the rich people. This will take another 20 years till this actually happens, because nobody really wants to do that. Nobody really dares. In Germany, you can really see and sense that the rich and the big corporations are allowed to do anything at this point. Like Volkswagen and all these corporations, they can do whatever they want. This government is not going to stop them. So maybe we as people need to figure out a way to do this. So I believe in words as magic, magic in the modern term magic, the words that surround us create our reality. So this is what, which words we use and the words that we surround ourselves with. Also the people that we surround ourselves with, the symbols and whatnot. That's why we want to work with words. We could do the same thing with images. Now, just a few little things. I don't want to talk about magic in general because that would be another talk. But I found it very fascinating that these word systems have been around for, you could say, thousands of years. Yeah? Like the creation of seals, for example. I don't know if anyone ever heard about a seal. If you take a sentence like, I want to meet my soulmate, which is kind of a stupid wish in the first place, but that's the example. And then you take up all the letters, delete every letter that is double, and then you just create a graphic symbol out of these letters. And then maybe, something like this comes out, this is just letters arranged into sort of a logo. And you shift it around until something comes out, that you like. And then, I don't know, maybe get it tattooed, draw it on the wall, or put it in a drawer, but it prints it into your subconscious, and it will always remind you of that one thing that it actually says, I want to be with my soulmate. And that could be anything that you want, any direction you want to take in life. You can turn it into words, turn it into a symbol, and make it part of your reality, therefore. Nike, Adidas, all these corporations, they do this all the time with you. So make your own symbols, make your own symbols. Don't let them tell you what your vision is like in life. That's very stupid. That's like my game, what I do, because I'm very easily to be influenced. I'm a very weak person, so that's why I have a lot of tattoos that remind me, like, every day, you are this, you are that, you need to do this and that, because I forget all the time. So, I don't know if you know the movie Memento, about this guy who basically loses his memory every day, so he needs to get tattoos every day to keep track of all the days and find the guy who murdered his wife. So, that's how he ends up. So, that's the title of our whole talk today. Dreadnought is old English, and it means fear nothing. Because that's the thing, again, when I thought about why do I come here? I don't make any money out of this, I paid for my own flight, why the fuck do I come here? Because I am not afraid to venture into new territories, to meet new people, to stand here and talk to people, because I do need, I feel urgent to explore the world, to evolve as a human being and share these ideas with other people. Hopefully, we all become sweeter human beings on that quest. Be nice to each other, let's spread a little bit of love and let's just not be stupid and not be afraid. Yeah? Whatever people tell you, don't back off. If you have a good idea, go for it, follow it and pursue it. In the end, next to each other, that's all we got. Thank you very much. And Nietzsche and Schopenhauer. It really depends on who are you, what do you know, what text did you read? You know? That's something that I forgot to say. I'm an avid reader. I've been reading everything from simplistic skateboarding shit to philosophy. So it's all in my mind. Whenever I say something, do something, I already do cutting and pasting all the time. Because it's like that guy said, everything that we come up with, we heard somewhere, we overheard somewhere, we read somewhere, we saw somewhere. And if you do cut and paste as an artistic practice, it's just a more conscious act of getting in there into your subconscious mind and the vast sammelsurium, that's a German word, it's like a collection of books, comics, posters and whatnot, and you very consciously take this bit and this bit and this bit, and it's actually hard work to think about how do I make connections between these bits. Because it's not just random, especially if you like, we want to make a book. In the end, if you close the book, there should have been a story. There should have been a message. Does that answer your question?
Okay. Maybe anyone else? Okay, thank you. Thank you for listening.
Another question. You said that you believe that words are magic. From the definition of magic, we know that magic is making something, be it by direct means or indirect means. Therefore, I assume you believe in the power of art in the general sense of word to influence the process, I mean the overall existence, human existence. But you also mentioned Dadaists, and you know that one of their main weapons were manifests. Manifests were intended to exercise influence on society from within. Because back then, people used to believe that society can still be changed from within. Nowadays, it is quite clear, I believe, especially regarding our post-capitalist society, that it is impossible, in a sense. And it is also about the thing that Groves mentioned. When you are offered everything, the only option you've got is to reject everything. You know, when we've got such an abundance of shallow freedoms, such as, you know, consumerism society, you know, consumerism paradise, the only option we've got is to reject everything, to reject maybe life as such, be it such a radical decision, but it's the only option left, or to influence society from outside. That is, to fight it directly, but by means of terror or by means of political theory, I don't know. So how do you connect your belief in words as magic and the situation we are?
I can answer this very straightforward. I've been doing this for myself for the past 20 years. I used to be a very consumerist first world kid. Now I'm a grown up with two kids and I basically freed myself from more or less that's something that I can claim for myself. I just have to believe this, yeah? Because I'm talking about myself now. I freed myself through the practice of my own, let's call it magic, to become a free human being and not be dependent on these fake promises. So I know this works. Now I have two little children. With them, I work into the same direction. I constantly meet people. I don't want to change society from within society. I want to talk to specific people at a given point in time, and hopefully, I don't even know that saying, each one, teach one. Teach one, teach another one, teach another one. Like I have been taught by a professor in university. 20 years ago, I was handed a book by Robert Anton Wilson called The New Prometheus. about how you can reinvent yourself more or less. That's reprogram yourself. Very much rooted also in the ideas of NLP, stuff that I refuse at this point. It's not something I'm interested in. I'm not interested in psychology. But that book forever changed my life because I realized I am in control of who I want to be and the people around me. No one else, not my parents, not the society, no one. So that's, I don't know if that answers your questions. I know for myself it does work, so let's do it all together. And I'm also, I didn't mention it, at school right now to become a healer, which is a very broad term, and I don't want to discuss this now on stage, but I will dedicate like the second half of my life, I'm more or less stopping design work in a few years, I guess, that's the plan. And dedicate myself to the world of, let's call it healing. Yeah? Because I think we need a lot of healing right now. The world is in really bad shape. I don't know if you know it, but from my perspective, we're fucking doomed.
Yeah, a reference to Robert Anton Wilson answers the need for the
Okay, but you know him, that's great.
Of course, Illuminatus trilogy is the... of course, the thank you very much.
Thank you.
Maybe someone else? Okay, we have the next lecture at 7 o'clock, so we hope you join us. Thank you.
What is it called, this lecture? What is the title of the lecture?
The world.